Welcome back to Paranormal Tedium. Boldly going where no other paranormal channel dares to go, with another episode in the series, Rich's Complete and Utter Breakdown. Broadcasting loud and strong from within the depths of the Lard facility, it's here where I check out the devices used by ghost hunters in their pursuits to capture evidence of spirit communication and other supernatural knavery, then try to determine if they really work. So stay tuned, we're about to find out. If you check out pretty much any of the ghost hunting TV shows and YouTube channels these days, then you'll no doubt come across one of these little buggers, the PSB7 Spirit Box. This one's the PSB7T version, but the original device was first seen on a Ghost Adventures Live episode back on the 30th of October 2009. Now, this is by no means the only Spirit Box available, there are others, but it is the one invented by Gary Galka. It's also the third and last device of his that I'll be breaking down in this series. If you don't know who Gary is or how he started making these devices, then go check out my Melmeter vid. In the US, these spirit boxes are typically available for $99. Here in the UK, they're usually around the 99 quid mark. Plus shipping, of course. If you follow us on our Facebook page, which I strongly suggest you go and check out, then you'll know that I didn't pay anywhere near that price, thankfully. So what do spirit boxes do? Well, the ProMeasure website, which is the site where Gary sells all his ghost hunting devices, direct to the gull. I mean, to ghost hunters. States that, when used by properly trained individuals under certain circumstances, our spirit box will provide results similar to that of an EVP recorder, but in real time. The site doesn't elaborate on the certain circumstances, and I'm not sure your everyday ghost hunter qualifies as a properly trained individual either, but we'll just run with it. In any case, your intrepid ghost hunter will ask questions into the ether, then wait for responses from the astral plane. All whilst the spirit box sweeps through the AM or FM radio frequencies, either forwards or in reverse, and at a sweep rate that can be chosen from a set range. I have questions. How are these responses not just radio station contamination? Why does the spirit box need to sweep through the frequencies for supposed ghosts and spirits to be able to communicate? And what is the originating information and documentation that the process for how this device works is based on? Before I even try to begin to answer all of these questions, how about giving this vid a thumbs up? Just this small gesture from you makes a huge difference to us here at the facility. If we get more thumbs up than we did for the last breakdown vid, we might be allowed cake. Also, please consider subscribing to the channel, remembering to click the bell icon. We've got loads of stuff in the pipeline, so we'd hate for you to miss out. Right, I think the best way to answer all of my previous questions would be to start with the last one. So let's jump straight in. The theory behind how these devices work is that ghost spirits and entities can communicate via white noise, commonly known as static. This is the fucking awful hiss heard in between stations when tuning a radio or a really old analog TV. White noise, in this instance, is the audio manifestation of the cosmic microwave background radiation, or CMBR, which is present throughout the universe. According to the inflation model of the origins of the universe, more commonly known as the Big Bang Theory, CMBR is a byproduct of the initiation of the universe nearly 14 billion years ago. So who came up with the theory that supernatural entities can communicate in this way? Well, like seemingly every twatting subject that I research that relates to the paranormal, there's extremely little specific information to be gleaned. What info there is just sends you round in circles. If anyone, after watching this vid, has a definitive lead, then please let me know down in the comments. What I would suggest, though, is that the theory was most definitely impressed on society's collective subconscious by the release of the movie Poltergeist back in 1982. And is most probably responsible for most of today's current belief in this theory. From the research I've put into this subject, it appears that the theory most probably originated out of the quest for EVPs. with the likes of Attila von Salle, Friedrich Jürgensen and Konstantin Rodive. But whereas these early EVP progenitors were only recording alleged spirit voices onto vinyl or reel-to-reel tape for later review, a spirit box alleges real-time two-way communication. So who came up with that idea? The first of these devices appears to have been the Spiricom. This device was the brainchild of one George Meek back in 1970. Meek claimed to have gotten the design information via a medium from the spirit world. In 1975, Meek became acquainted with one William O'Neill, who was an electronics engineer and self-professed medium. O'Neill had also been working on a similar device, and in 1977 claimed to have successfully established two-way audio communications with his spirit guide, Doc Nick.
Hi everybody!
This interested Meek to the point where he and O'Neill began work on the Spiricom Mark III with guidance from Doc Nick. The last version of the Spiricom was the Mark IV, and the complete 120-page technical manual is freely available online, to which I'll leave a link in the vid description. Before I move on, it would be remiss of me not to mention the Frank's Box and its creator, Frank Sumption. Also known as the Ghost Box, this device appears to more closely resemble modern-day spirit boxes, although it only swept through the AM frequency band. According to a blog on the Sinister Coffee and Creamery website, Sumption also claimed he received his design instructions from the spirit world, who also informed him he was a purple princess from a planet called Pleiades. Seriously, a purple princess from the planet Pleiades? Moving swiftly on, but a pattern does appear to be emerging, don't you think? Sumption made 180 of these devices, of which only 97 currently remain, and were given away for free, but only to those that the spirits instructed him to. As for exactly how this process is supposed to work, not one person within the ghost hunting community has been able to supply me with an answer. Trust me, I've asked. Oh, they'll state it's all down to twatting energy, energy, energy till they're blue in the face, but nobody seems to know in what form this energy takes. Even though science has had a fucking pretty good handle on all the types of energy that exists for a while now. When asked, all people will say is, we know it just works. Reaching much? Moving on to the second question, why do spirit boxes need to sweep? If supposed spirits can communicate via white noise, why not pick just one frequency that's purely white noise with zero radio contamination and try receiving ghostly voices there? The answers to these questions are inextricably linked to my first question about radio station contamination. To get to those answers, I feel I need to explain my initial experiments with the spirit box before discussing my thoughts on this. The first thing I did upon receiving my spirit box, and I challenge all spirit box users to do the same before they perform any session in a location. Just do it. I know you won't. Was to create a list of every single frequency that the PSB7 picks up on both the AM and FM bands. On the AM band, this device starts at 520 kHz and goes up to 1710 kHz in increments of 10 kHz. So that's 120 distinct frequencies. On the FM band, it starts at 87.5 MHz and goes up to 108 MHz in increments of 0.1 MHz or 100 kHz. So that's 206 distinct frequencies. Then I manually scanned through each frequency on both bands and noted down the frequencies where radio stations came through. What I found was most interesting. Radio station transmissions bleed over into adjacent frequencies, which is more apparent on the FM band. The spread of frequencies can be up to 5 increments where a station can still be heard. However, this does still occur on the AM band, where specific radio station frequencies fall just off the 10 kHz increment step. This is usually within 2 to 3 kHz. So what does this mean? To me, it means that when TV shows and YouTube channels state things like what we heard spanned multiple frequencies, therefore couldn't possibly be radio contamination, is that they're full of shit. Or they're just out and out lying to you. The sweep rate at which frequencies are cycled through is also a factor. As mentioned near the start of this vid, the rate, which is denoted in milliseconds, is somewhat adjustable within a set range. On this Rev 5 version, The range is 100, 150, 200, 250, 300 and 350 milliseconds for both AM and FM bands. On the Rev 4 version, the AM band has different sweep rates that go up to 500 milliseconds or half a second. This means that the slower the sweep rate, the longer the spirit box will linger on any one frequency, thus having more of a chance of capturing words or part phrases from radio station broadcasts. Let's have a closer look into this and get some data. For the purposes of this experiment, I used the FM band and a sweep rate of 250 milliseconds, or quarter of a second, just to make the calculation simpler. One sweep cycle of the previously calculated 206 frequencies within the FM band takes precisely 51 and a half seconds, which is also the same duration between when an individual radio broadcast will be heard repeated on every sweep cycle thereafter. The number of radio stations received will depend upon the location of the device, and in some locations, the time the device is activated. For a quarter of a second sweep rate, this also means that each of the 10 FM radio stations that can be picked up within the LARD facility will potentially be audible for up to a second and a quarter. So a Rev 4 version, sweeping the AM band at 500 milliseconds, means that stations will be audible from between half a second and a second, all of which is ample time for a word or part of a phrase to be heard. Therefore, in this particular experiment, we hear between 10 and 11 and a half seconds of intermittent partial music and speech every 51 and a half seconds. Again, results and durations will vary, dependent upon the location, sweep rate, and how many stations can be picked up by the device in that particular location. As a control experiment, I also chose a frequency that was the furthest away from any radio station transmissions, and that received only white noise. I ran both experiments for 5 minutes and asked the same questions at the same intervals. I've uploaded the full vid showing this experiment, which you can check out here. There are more experiments in this series to come, so watch this space. The results are pretty conclusive and show exactly why spirit boxes need to sweep, because if it didn't, you wouldn't get any twatting responses. Now we've shown how these devices actually work and what they receive, we need to discuss what factors and processes are at play when intrepid ghost hunters appear to get responses. As previously mentioned in my voice recorder breakdown with regards to EVPs, auditory pareidolia and psychoacoustics play a huge part when interpreting alleged paranormal audio. Even though the human brain is the most phenomenal organ and does amazing things, on both conscious and subconscious levels, it is prone to perceptual errors. To understand that, we'll need to get a few basic concepts down first. Let's start with language. All languages are made up of what are known as phonemes. As defined on ProWritingAid.com, a phoneme is the smallest unit of sound that makes up a complete word. Just a small number of these phonemes make up every single word, dependent on the language spoken. For example, the common consensus is that there are 44 distinct phonemes that make up the entire English language. That's just 44 individual and unique sounds that make up each of the ever-increasing number of words we use today. If we take into account the sweep rate being used at the time of the spirit box session, the chances are that only snippets of words or phrases will be heard at any given point. This then gives rise to the potential misinterpretation of the phonemes heard as other words, which is where auditory pareidolia comes into play. We're trained and wired from an early age to recognise and understand human speech. So when we're subjected to something approximating human speech, our brains try to make sense and understand it. To show this process in action, I've linked a vid by a channel called Monotone Tim that I highly recommend you go and watch. In it are examples of popular songs that have been converted to MIDI, which are then played back on a MIDI piano. As the software they've used to perform the conversion can't separate out the vocals from the music, everything is converted. The results are most interesting, especially when you realise that all you're hearing are piano notes. Let's say our intrepid ghost hunter is doing a spirit box session in a cemetery or graveyard. Yes, there is a difference. They've already asked if there are any spirits wishing to communicate and gotten what they perceive to be a response to the affirmative. Chances are, the next question will be something along the lines of, "Can you tell me your name?" The very next thing to be heard that sounds like a name will be taken as the name of the supposed ghost or spirit. I'm going to go into why this is the case in a bit, but for now we'll just concentrate on the word itself. Let's say our intrepid ghost hunter hears this.
Alan.
Now I'm not going to buy issue like all the ghost hunting TV shows and YouTube channels do and plant the suggestion of what this name could be. But what I am going to do is play three sound clips that could potentially be heard in the context of a radio broadcast. I'll leave it to you to decide where the first clip could potentially fall within each of the following. Here we go.
That was Kiss with Helen Highwater from the album Hot in the Shade.
So how did you come across this information?
Well, I was mainly concentrating on files between L and Q. This next song is by John Cougar Mellencamp.
Did you hear it? If not, don't worry. Here's the original clip again.
Alan.
Now, here's the sections of the latter three clips where the similar sound occurs.
With Helen Highwater. Between Alan Q. John Cougar Mellencamp.
There are a plethora of instances where this type of misinterpretation of these intermittent sound bites, which are thrown out by spirit boxes, can occur. Now I'm sure there'll be people in the comments section below ranting, Rich, if it's all just radio contamination and pareidolia, how come I get intelligent responses to my questions? Well, there are a shit ton of other cognitive biases and effects that should be taken into consideration when anyone conducts a spirit box session and when reviewing the evidence. To mention all of these would be way beyond the scope of this vid, so I'll just quickly go over a couple. As I've mentioned in other vids, we are working on a vid, and potentially a series of vids, specifically about the different psychological biases and effects which are prevalent within the paranormal community. So keep an eye out for them when they drop. Have you noticed how when performing a spirit box session, ghost hunting channels ask questions and keep asking questions? Then, when one responds appears to answer the last question, that's the proof of an intelligent response. They downplay or completely dismiss all the previous times they asked a question and either got the wrong response. For example, getting music or a word form response that wasn't a proper noun when specifically asking for names. A garbled response or no twatting response whatsoever. Well that right there, that's confirmation bias at work, and it's rife within the paranormal community. The definition of confirmation bias is the tendency to actively seek out, favour, interpret and recall information in a way that only confirms a pre-existing belief, and not look for, or just completely fucking ignore, any and all information that contradicts or challenges that belief. Which is what we see time and time again in all ghost hunting TV shows and YouTube channels. Next, we humans are extremely adept at attributing meaning to completely random and or coincidental events that we perceive to be more than pure chance. For example, if you dream, think or talk about someone and that day or the next that someone gets in contact with you, does that mean you're psychic or have precognitive abilities? Let's go back to our previously mentioned intrepid ghost hunter performing a spirit box session amongst the gravestones. They now have what they perceive to be the name for the alleged spirit they're talking to. They perform a quick scan of the surrounding gravestones, which reveals one with the same name. This will then become the focus for their next round of questions. Is this the grave of the talkative spirit? How many other gravestones bear the same name? It's all food for thought. So, in the face of all the information we've gone through in this vid, is there any fucking wonder that what's output from spirit boxes is interpreted as spirit communication by intrepid ghost hunters? Before spirit box users can categorically state that what they're getting in sessions are actual spirit communications, they must exercise more control over these sessions. As mentioned earlier in this vid, whenever a spirit box session is performed in a location for the first time, a manual sweep of all the frequencies should be performed, to which a note of each radio station heard should be made against the corresponding frequencies. Also, a camera should be focused on and recording the spirit box for the entire duration of the session. That way, if an alleged response is heard when the footage is reviewed, a check can be made against the list of frequencies and radio stations. This will then determine if said response fell on a frequency that contains a radio station transmission or not. If it did, then it should be dismissed. Irrespective of all of this, the argument over whether spirit boxers do indeed receive spirit voices may all soon come to a head, when the switchover from analog to digital radio occurs. This means that at some point in the very near future, there will no longer be any transmissions on the AM/FM frequency bands, with potentially a very few exceptions. On that day, the collective sphincters of the entire ghost hunting community will be twitching harder than a rabbit's nose in a crop of carrots. The switchover will either mean that spirit box users will be completely vindicated, as voices will still be heard even in the absence of radio station contamination. And as one, they'll shout a big fuck you to all the hardcore skeptics and non-believers. Or they'll be left with a then proven to be useless piece of kit, as absolutely nothing is heard on it from that point on. To which all proponents of the spirit box will then have to swallow their pride and admit that they've just been talking to themselves all along. In the meantime though, I'm sure the entire ghost hunting community will continue to assert that spirit box communication is genuine. But time will tell, and we'll just have to wait and see. Who's excited for the radio digital switchover? I know we are. Leave your thoughts on the use of spirit boxes and on which way you think the switchover will go down in the comments. Whichever way it goes, you can be sure that Paranormal Tedium will be there to cover, analyse, discuss and potentially take the piss in the aftermath. With that in mind, please give this vid a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Also, subscribe to the channel and smash that bell icon to get notifications for all the content we upload in the future. Thanks for watching.